So, we will start to first take one of the reaction of n pi star reactivity. That is, we said we will start with alpha cleavage reaction. Today, we will understand alpha cleavage reactions. If you take a ketone and if you shine light, it undergoes a type of photo decarbonylization. And this reaction was first observed by Norrish, you know, R.G.W. Norrish. He is the person who first observed this photo decarbonylation of ketone. That is why we call this alpha cleavage reaction. You can, otherwise, you can call us Norrish type 1 process. So, you can call this alpha cleavage reaction, or you can call this as a Norrish type 1 process. Basically, there are 3 types of ketones in which you can observe these reactions. One, you can see it in a saturated acyclic ketones, where you can see alpha cleavage reaction taking place. Another, you can see it in saturated cyclic ketones. Then you can observe in beta gamma unsaturated ketones. So, this 3 ketones try to do this photo decarbonylization reaction, or you call them as a Norrish type 1 process. So, what I will do is that we will take one ketones, like initially we will take saturated acyclic ketone and see some examples how this undergoes a Norrish type. Then we go for saturated cyclic system, where you can take 6 membered, 5 membered, 4 member rings and see how they undergoes this. And finally, we will work out with beta gamma unsaturated ketones. So, first I will take system of saturated acyclic ketones. See, if you take a saturated acyclic ketones, most of the time you see like 4 in UV spectrum. If you take the UV of this saturated acyclic ketones, you can see 4 bands. Okay. And this 4 bands will be centered, one will be at 155 nanometer, one you can see at 170 nanometer, another around 195 nanometer, another is 280 nanometer. So, you can see this 4 type of absorption bands when you take for an simple saturated acyclic ketones. And this 280 nanometer is the one where you do your n pi star transition. This is your n pi star transition. It is a little bit weak transition, but you can do your chemistry there. That means, if you shine a light greater than 280 or around 280 nanometer, you can do your n pi star excitation, then you will see your n pi star reactivity. Clear? So, most of the time we will be shining like greater than 280 nanometers. So, now I will take a first example where I have a ketone, okay, where the both side of my both the arm of my ketone are symmetrical, are same. Okay. So, we will take first that type of ketone, simple ketone. For example, I am taking C6H5CH2 carbonyl. Where both are symmetrical, both the arms of this ketones are same. So we are taking a simple ketone. Now what we'll do, we can do this, most of this Norrish type 1 reactions can be encountered in gas phase. Okay. There are some examples where you can do it in the solution also, but most of the time it is encountered in the gas phase. So if I shine this with light, okay, greater than 280 or 310 nanometer, you know that what you get? You get your I call this as S1, which you have studied. Then it undergoes a very nice intersystem crossing. So I get my triplet set. You can call them as T1. You can put with the spin also, or you can directly write S1 and T1. Instead of writing the structure, you can always write S1, T1. That also means that you can just write S1, then undergoes an intersystem crossing to T1. Like this also you can write for simple. So now what happens? Now this alpha cleavage, okay, alpha to your carbon here, can that particular bond can cleave the excited state. It can be this side or it can be on the other side, both are same since you are taking a symmetrical type of molecule. Okay. So you will get so what you are getting? You are getting a acyl radical and you are getting an alkyl radical. So you are taking a ketone, just you are shining light, the alpha to the carbonyl cleaves to give you two types of radicals. One you get an acyl as well as an alkyl radical. This entire process where photochemistry happens is called as a primary process. Because all your photochemistry has happened in this region. So excitation, cleavage till to you get acyl and alkyl radical is done in light, okay, and it happens in a, and that is why you call this as a primary process. Clear? After that, what happens? Now you have your acyl radical which you have generated C6H5C dot plus you have your alkyl radical. This friend. Now what happens, this C6H5 that is your acyl radical undergoes decarbonylation. That means you get a cleavage here. So you get C6H5CH2 dot plus you get your have a decarbonylation happening. Followed by your decarbonylation step, you get a radical recombination. See, now I have a radical C6H5CH2 dot. Now this C6H5CH2 dot can react with get radical recombination. Okay. So I get this So, this two process, you call this as secondary. So, in the primary process, it is the photochemistry happening place, where you have formation of acyl as well as alkyl radical. In the case of your secondary process, it is a radical chemistry. So, you get an acyl radical, it undergoes a decarbonylization to give you a alkyl, which then undergoes a radical recombination to give you the product. If I write, then I have C6H5CH2 carbonyl . This is the overall chemistry of this. Now, we will take a second type of example. First, we take a ketone, acyclic ketone, where both the arms are same. Now, we will take a ketone in which both the arms are different and see how the Norrish type 1 reaction happens there. I am taking this ketone now. Now, what happens once I shine light, it goes to singlet, that you can always write, you get S1, and then it undergoes an intersystem crossing to my T1, that is fine. So, I have taken a triplet excited ketone. So, it gets excited to my triplet T1. It is in a T1 state. Now, you have to think about your alpha cleavage reaction. So, I can say I can cleave this side, call it as an A, or I can cleave this side, call it as B. Okay. So, we will write both the possibilities. So, if I cleave here, I might get methyl radical that is if I go IIA. If I go to take the root of B, then I should get this radical. So, I can get any thought? I can get this 2. Now, you have to decide like which will be the path. Okay. So, you can take A or B, which will be the one? B. So, you are thinking about the first thing, that is the most stable radical, you can do that alpha cleavage on that direction. So, that is the first thing. It is not generally all the case. I will tell you how it varies. It also depends upon others also. But initially, for this example, yes, it is clear that you are getting a stable radical. That is why you are taking the alpha cleavage in that direction. Right? So, this is your primary process. Now we will go and do the secondary process. So, we are saying this is the right one. So, it is not going because of the stability of radical. Now, you know what is the first step in your secondary process, decarbonylation, right. So, I can take my radical and do my you get this fine. Now, what happens? You have your radical recombination. So, radical recombination here you have to think because it is not like a simple. In the previous example, you had a type of symmetrical. In this case, it both the arms are different. So, your methyl radical can combine to give you. So, this possibility you can get, okay, or can get this any other your tertiary butyl radical can get this products. So, it looks to be simple chemistry, but you have to identify all the products. So, the key is that can be under see the secondary process, all the radical recombination can be write it up. So, if I jot this reaction, if I summarize this, basically I say that I have CH3 I get one of this product, have missed any product? Any other products? In this hydrogen abstraction, yeah, that I will go, that is good. So, we will take another example in which I will explain you how it happens, okay. That is good. We basically are saying the particular hydrogen abstraction happening, yeah, yes, that you can see also. So, this is one of the where you have two different things of symmetry. Now, what we will take? We will take another type of acyclic ketones where you will have a different arms, but you will have a beta hydrogen. In that case, what will be the primary process and secondary process? That will be a little bit interesting. So, that will be our third example. Okay. Then we will get into the much more fundamental of it. Did it. Any doubt? So I'm taking a ketone layer. Okay. So I say that I have a beta hydrogens here. Carbonyl, you have an alpha and you have a beta. So your carbon has an hydrogen. So I take ketone in this type. Okay, and see what happens here. As you said. Yeah, once I shine light, it goes to the singlet, then it undergoes an intersystem crossing to a triplet. From the triplet, we say that this is an excited ketone, from your triplet it happens. So, I say T1. So, both the sides are there. Okay. As you know, I can do an alpha cleavage here. Or I can do an alpha cleavage in this direction, A, B. And the rest of the molecule, right? Again, you can, based on your stability, you can say that which part you are going to take. So, this, which of this will be better? This one. Yes. So, we say this is, okay. So, that is your primary process, right? Done. So, we will see how the secondary process happens in this. This will be interesting to see the secondary process. So, in the secondary process, you have seen that the first secondary process is what? Decarbonylation followed by radical recombination. So, shall we do that? So, I will get my CH2 dot plus my CO out. Then I have to do my radical recombination. So, this is so, if I do my radical recombination, so I can have my dot plus I get one of this product. Right. So, the other product will be CH3 CH2 dot plus get one more product. So in the secondary process, the first, that is decarbonylation, followed by intramolecular, followed by your radical recombination, I can get three products. Okay, 1, 2, 3. Now, what happens if you have a beta hydrogen? Okay, one more secondary process happens. That is your intramolecular hydrogen abstraction. That will take place. So, we will see how that secondary process happens. So, I have two systems now, like I have my two radicals CH3, CH2, carbonyl dot plus I have my CH dot. See, I have now these two radicals. See, one secondary process was decarbonylation followed by radical recombination. Here you can see if these two radicals are there, what they can do. I can take this radical, okay. This radical can abstract this hydrogen and then I can make a double bond here. Yes, that you can do. So, you might get then what? So, you get an aldehyde plus you will get to a your alkene, right? Okay. Is this intramolecular hydrogen abstraction, that's we call this as A. There is another intramolecular hydrogen abstraction can also happen, that is we call as B. For example, I have my, see it is a simple reaction, you can now see how many products it is trying to form. Now, why this can't pick up this, sorry, this is a radical, it can do like this, no? This radical can take this hydrogen, that is possible. So, if it takes what we will get, CH3, CH, what is this? So, you get ketene, the formation of ketene is the driving force for that reaction. So, you get a ketene plus this product. Fine. If you have a solvent like ROH, so you know what happens, ketene reacts with your, yeah, that you can form your ester, right? If it is, if the reaction is done in methanol or ethanol solvent, if it is gas based, then you can see your ketene. Ketene will be there, then it undergoes decarbonylation, other process happens of the ketene. But in the solvent, you can trap your ketenes. So, see, it is a simple process. I have taken a simple acyclic ketone. And you can see how many product it gives. That's why Norrish type 1 is not only on decarbonylation. Yeah, the primary process is decarbonylation. But then you get, once you get alpha cleavage, then you get your acyl and alkyl radical. Then it's more about the radical reactivity. Okay. So shall we summarize this reaction and write all the products so that at least we know how many products this has given? You have a CH3, CH2. You have an carbonyl, you have CH, CH3 CH2 CH3. So you have this. So you should think in, like, if it is undergoing a decarbonylization followed by radical recombination, then what are the products you can expect? Then you write the products of that. And you say that, yes, I will expect CH3 CH2 CH CH3 CH2 CH3. This one I can expect, right? Then I can expect another product CH3 CH2 CH2 CH3. This I can expect, or I can expect I will say that I am expecting this three products, we call it 1, 2, and 3. We can find out three products. Okay, so we will call this as a decarbonylation followed by your radical recombination. Then we will write from here and we will say that it is an intermolecular hydrogen abstraction. Then what I can expect? If it is from abstracting this beta hydrogen, then you write as, you get your aldehyde plus you get your alkene. All right. So if it is other way around, then you get your ketene plus right. So you are now getting three sets of products, one radical recombination product that is after decarbonylization, another you are getting intramolecular hydrogen abstraction, there you are, you can take hydrogen from both the beta hydrogen, then you can get two types of product, one ketene based and another is your aldehydes. So it is like a simple chemistry, right? Looks like a simple compound, you shine light, now you have to get so much of products and you keep on isolating one by one. Okay, that is good. So these are the acyclic ketones. Major examples are these three. When you take an acyclic ketone, see, when once a compound is given, for example, you are given an acyclic saturated ketone, then you first think whether it is a symmetrical. Okay. If it is both the arms are same, then you say, yes, I have only one reaction here happening, one will be my primary process, that there will be no option because they are same, so I will get only one cleavage, and from that I have to think decarbonylization followed by my radical recombination. If my ketone, where my both the arms are different, then first thing I have to see is that which radical will be formed, whether I am going stability of the radical, I will say that which should be formed. Once I figure out that part, then I will do my decarbonylization, but writing radical recombination, you will be thinking about the cross products. Initial case, you are not thinking about the cross products when they are symmetrical. This time you have to think about your cross product. As you move, then when you have a ketone, once you have your ketone, okay, then if you have a beta hydrogen on both the sides, in that case what you do is that you have your decarbonylation alpha cleavage products, then you get your decarbonylation, right. And the more importantly, you have to get another secondary process, that is your intramolecular hydrogen abstraction. Okay. So, this part you should be, see the one which I have written, that is your decarbonation, radical recombination followed by your intramolecular hydrogen abstraction. This process, okay, this plays a very important role in many reactions. When you go for cyclic systems, where you mostly see your intramolecular hydrogen abstraction reactions, that is the formation of ketene and aldehydes will be regularly formed. Clear? Okay. Are you fine with three systems? These are the three best examples of your acyclic systems. Now, what we will do is that we will slowly try to understand something like I said that I have a C6, I have taken your first example, that is C6H5CS2 carbonyl C6H5. So, what happens, what two radicals I get in the Norrish type 1 process, primary process? I get one acyl radical and I get an alkyl radical. How to know this, that I am getting these radicals? Okay, you just do an alpha cleavage and you say that I get acyl radical and alkyl radical. How to know that I am getting this acyl radical and alkyl radical? Anyone? By? Yeah, you can do trapping experiments. Okay. See, once you do the trapping experiment, then you can find out whether these radicals are there. So, the best you can do a trapping experiment. So, what you regularly use to trap this type of radicals? You can use TEMPO. Okay. TEMPO is normally used to trap this radical. I will write the structure of TEMPO. This is a very good radical tool because it is stable and you can use it, it can easily trap things. So, if you want to know the name, it is 2244 tetramethyl piperidine one oxide. This is a very good trapping agent. Okay. So, we will see how this can trap. If I have my C6H5CS2 carbonyl CS2 C6H5. So, you know that it goes to singlet and then intersystem crossing to triplet, then it undergoes an alpha cleavage to give me C6H5CS2, give me an acyl radical plus an alkyl radical. If I have a TEMPO, when I do the photolysis, if I add TEMPO to the system and carry out my reaction, then what happens? So, this can combine with your acyl radical. So, you can get C6H5CS2 carbonyl. Yeah, it is better to write like this. Okay. You can get your ester. Or if it is going to trap here, then you will get C6H5CS2O. Yes. Oh, I can write it in this way itself. So you can get your ether. Right. From the now this products are stable. So you can isolate these products and take a number. From that you will know that whether you whether this reaction actually you get this radical, acyl radical or alkyl radical. Fine? Okay. Now we'll spend little bit time to understand about alpha cleavage. Okay, I will take a very nice example. Like, take benzophenone. See, whatever so far I was trying the systems, acyclic ketone systems, or you have acetophenone. This type of systems. If I shine light on, for example, I take benzophenone. Okay, I shine light on benzophenone. What do you expect? I shine light on benzophenone at 280 nanometer. What you can expect? So you expect that it goes to singlet, then goes to triplet, and undergoes an alpha cleavage to give you the product, but this doesn't happen at all. Okay, you cannot. Benzophenone never undergoes any alpha cleavage reaction. Instead of that, it does very good energy transfer process. It is a very good sensitizer. You use benzophenone because if it undergoes alpha cleavage, then you are not going to use that as a sensitizer, right? So why it doesn't happen? Yes, sir. Yeah, that's why I took this example. It's not about only the stability of the radical we are talking about. Okay, the fundamental thing of n pi star transition is that, or any chemistry, the photochemistry happens from the lowest excited state. What the photochemistry happens only from the lowest excited state. For example, I have a system where my n pi star is the lowest. Okay, then the photochemistry happens. If you take benzophenone, I have a ground state S0, okay. Its n pi star transition, that is your singlet n pi star, and same way if you see is, this is singlet n pi star, it is a, if you see the energy is basically 100 kilocalories. It is 100 kilocalories per mole. But what happens is that it has another thing, which is your pi pi star. In this transition, you have another, that is it has this pi pi star transition also there at S1. That is, if you see, that is only 76 kilocalories per mole. So, which is the lowest excited state now? Pi pi star, right? That is why you cannot see any n pi star reactivity here. Okay. So, that why I want to say that, see, when you do an alpha cleavage, it not only depends on your radical formation. Yes, you have to see the radical formation. It not only depends on the radical formation, it also depends upon your from which excited state it is happening. Okay. If your n pi star is the lowest excited state, then you can see Norrish type 1 reaction. If it is, see, in this case what happens, the pi pi star is the lowest excited, so you will see most of the pi pi star chemistry here. Clear? Any doubt? This you should know definitely. Any photochemistry happens only from the lowest excited state. Okay. Now, I have written two examples right now. One is CH3C11 thing, another is with a phenyl. Okay, now you know that which side it will cleave, okay, based on your tertiary metal radical. But I am asking now, among these two, which will react fast? Which reaction, whether you are A or B, which will react? So, here you are going to talk with respect to radical stability, or what you are going to talk about? Yes. Energy? Here you talk about your bond dissociation energy, right? So, how fast it is going to cleave? If you see the bond dissociation energy for your first one, that is, for example, we call it as K alpha bond dissociation energy, how fast it goes, it is like 10 to the power of 9 second inverse. Okay. When I take for the lower one, it is approximately 10 to the power of 7 second inverse. See, now I am slowly bringing you another concept, right? So, it is free radical stability you are going to talk, then you are going to talk about your excited state, whether my compound is in the lower excited state, then you have to understand which will be the faster. Dissociation also you should understand. For example, now you will know, if I give you these three examples, you can easily understand. Yeah, it depends upon again the radical stability, but you should know. I have a system like CH2 phenyl, system like phenyl carbonyl C, I am replacing by 1-methyl, a system like phenyl carbonyl. I like this three systems. Now, we will call this as again A, B, C. So, which will be cleaving fast, or which C? So, if I see it is, or if I see its bond, it is 1 into 10 to the power of 8 second inverse. Is just to you guys to understand, okay. And this is 3 into 10 to the power of 7, and this is 2 into 10 to the power of 6. So, you should know basically the how fast the reaction goes when you are given like two system, okay. If I put two together and did the photolysis, what happens? Or among these three, which will be the faster to give me the alpha cleavage? Why you have to learn all this chemistry to, like, when you go competition between a Norrish type 1 and Norrish type 2 reaction, then you should know all these things. Because now I have just taken you a simple concept, that is Norrish type 1 reaction. See, the same compound, if I take the ketone and try to, I can, if I put an alpha, if I put a hydrogen in the gamma, then you will be thinking about your Norrish type 2 reaction. Then you should be able to see whether it will go first Norrish type 1, or it predominantly gives me a Norrish type 2 reactions. For that, you should know whether alpha cleavage process is faster, whether you get a stable radical, whether my excited state is lower, all this concept you should know. So, this is how, like, you can talk about your acyclic ketone systems, fine. This is your saturated acyclic ketones. I will just, if time permits, I might show you something about. Saturated cyclic ketone. So, we have seen up to now acyclic thing. We will see now Okay, we'll take saturated cyclic ketones. In this, you can basically we'll be working on 6-member ring. We will be working on 5-member ring system. 6-member ring system. We'll be working on 5-member ring system. We'll also we'll concentrate on this. Okay. We'll concentrate on this 3. Then we can take lot of examples. We have like 10-member, 12-member. We will do the example, but we will understand the chemistry of 6-member, 5-member, 4-member in detail. Okay. Then we will put examples for 10-member, 12-members or strain systems like that. We have to go. Okay. So I will take first example, that is your cyclohexanone. We will take a 6-member system or a style. So, we have a cyclohexanone system. Okay. What we will do is that we will try to understand cyclohexanone's photochemistry. Okay. Whether what type of first, what will be the primary process. Okay. And then we have to same way in the secondary process, we have to see 3 types, whether decarbonylation, radical recombination, then intramolecular hydrogen abstraction. There will be 2 different type process, whether this all happens or any other extra thing also happens in this reaction. Okay. In cyclohexanone, you will get radical recombination also happening. Okay. That depends upon your radical, whether you are getting 1,4 diradical system or you are getting 1,5 diradical system or 1,3, that also you have to understand. Okay. So, what we will do in the next class, we will start directly from the 6-member ring system, then we will see 5, then 4. After finishing that, then we will take an example of your beta gamma unsaturated ketones. There we will take like 4 or 5 examples, try to understand. Once we finish alpha cleavage, then we will go for beta cleavage. Then we will go for hydrogen abstraction reactions. This is our cleavage reactions. Then we have to go for hydrogen abstraction reactions. Clear? So, we end up our class with this.